Wave Sound Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of The Homestead in the Eucalypts by Léonie Kelsall, narrated by Casey Withoos. 1. Taylor. September 2008. She would probably die today. Road statistics no doubt proved that driving across the country with an emotionally unstable woman at the wheel was not a great idea. Taylor slid her gaze to her mum. Good. She was holding it together. Michelle usually made an effort when she had an audience, but on more than one occasion, Taylor had come home from uni to find her mother red-eyed, surrounded by a failed attempt at scrapbooking the wreckage of their family life. Mum generally blamed the mounds of soggy tissues on a Nicholas Sparks novel that hadn't moved from the coffee table for 8 months. When she was really messed up, there'd be chocolate wrappers. Taylor sighed, making sure to let the sound roll around the air-conditioned interior of the car. She was steadily eating her way through her own chocolate supply as they hurtled, although never above the speed limit, across the featureless plains between Sydney and Adelaide. She needed the sugar. Carbs, too. Pretty much anything that would allow her to stuff her emotions down inside, layered beneath chips and pastries. There was, though, a degree of almost pleasurable pain, like sneezing or wriggling a limb that had fallen asleep, knowing pins and needles would follow, in being separated early in a new relationship. Angst sharpened desire and heightened yearning. Angst and novelty, that was. Their recent 5-week anniversary had Zach temporarily entrenched in Taylor's I can't live without him territory. It didn't help in the slightest to know that her reaction was endorphin-driven. With his inked arms and nipple rings, Zach was high energy, exotic, and dangerous, a tantalizing contrast to her med school colleagues, most of whom mirrored her own permanent exhaustion. Gazing glassy-eyed at the brown nothingness of plains untouched by springtime green, Taylor's mind drifted back to yesterday and Zach's reaction to her plan. "I can't let Mum go alone," she'd said. "She's not in a good place. It's a 16-hour drive and she'll crank up some old sad crap and get lost in memories instead of concentrating on the road." What she hadn't said was that it was hard enough to get her mother to concentrate at the best of times. Taylor had inherited ambition and focus from her father, but none of Mum's relentless, thoroughly impractical positivity. The same irrational mindset that now saw them driving across the country for a brief visit to grandparents who lived the best part of 2,000 kilometres away. Even with airport delays, a 2-hour flight would have cut 3 days from the trip, days Taylor could ill afford to waste. But Mum maintained that flying was for bees, butterflies, bats and birds.
"Uh-huh, and how old is your mum, princess?"
Zach's dry sarcasm was sexy as all get-out. Except when directed at her. But he'd redeemed himself immediately.
"No, that's cool. Honestly, I'm jealous you have that kind of connection with your folks. Mine."
He trailed off, shrugging expressively, and she'd melted into his arms, wanting to take away his pain. He was wrong, though. Over the last few months, Mum had become increasingly distant. Taylor's sigh lifted her fringe as she reached for a soft drink they'd pulled over to get a couple of hundred kilometres back. Mum wasn't keen on buying from the Golden Arches. Apparently, anything purchased through a window was poison, most likely funded by Big Pharma, because that's where all evil originated. The soggy bottom fell out of her cup. "Oh, imagine what it does to your insides if it can do that to a takeaway cup," Mum said, her bamboo bangles colliding as she handed over a wad of recycled paper napkins from the stash in the console between them. "Phosphoric acid. I'm well aware of what it does." Mum should be relieved this was Taylor's only coke addiction. So many of her colleagues used medicinal doses to alleviate the stress of study, confidently assuring, or reassuring themselves, that they were smart enough not to allow cocaine to become a gateway drug. "All those brains, yet you still indulge." Mum never touched soft drink, or missed the chance for a lecture. Evidently, if you were an only child, you didn't get to grow up. Pulling out her phone, Taylor pressed her forehead to the window, letting the chill of the air-conditioned glass soothe her turmoil. "Cass, tell me I'm doing the right thing." The reply to her text was immediate, Her best friend lived on her phone. Can't do that, sweets. Zach's hot as, and you've done a runner? Told you, you're nuts. Way to be supportive. You know Mum's a bit off the rails at the moment. She says she needs to reconnect with family. Family? The irony is strong with that one. Taylor grimaced but continued reading. You've seen Zach's groupies. I wouldn't be giving him any alone time. Yeah, she sure had. Hordes of screaming women and men ogling her guy. Research proved that fame enhanced appeal, so it was logical that being on stage added to desirability. The moment she'd seen Zach, though, his shoulder-length jet hair backlit by nightclub stage lights as he powered into a finale, her hypothalamus had gone into overdrive, shutting down her more logical prefrontal cortex. Or, as Cassie maintained, lust trumped lobes. She huffed another frustrated breath, her fingers sliding over her phone keypad. Maybe you should keep an eye on him for me. I don't have the time or energy for that, not even for you. Just saying, he's not the kind of guy I'd leave hanging. Work, study, and Zach's gigs, not to mention the necessary reality of living with her parents in her 20s, meant that after little more than a month, that's exactly where their relationship was. Hanging. Mostly around the uni bar late in the day, when Zach would crawl from his bed and she had an hour's grace between lectures and work. They'd planned to synchronise schedules and grab a hotel room over the semester break. But not this week, thanks to Mum. Hearing you, but Mum needs me. Taylor tried not to let her gaze drift toward the stack of textbooks on the back seat. She had to carve out precious minutes to spend with Zach, yet here she was, wasting literally days on Mum. M-A-N-I-P-U-L-A-T-I-O-N spells Mum. Michelle's perfected the art of guilt-tripping you. Hats off to Tay's Mum. The halfway mark, Mum said, pointing at the sign for hay. Taylor guiltily set the phone on her lap, screen face down. Cassie was wrong. Her mother didn't manipulate. She was just emotionally needy. Get it? Mum continued. Halfway? Did you know this is the flattest landscape in Australia? Hopefully her quirked eyebrow would convey her lack of interest in Mum's teachable moment. Mum flicked her eyes from the ribbon of grey highway. So who's the guy? Come on, spill. I know you. You're pining. Zach. Saying his name set off flutters in Taylor's stomach, though the juvenile weakness irritated her. It wasn't like he was the first guy she'd hooked up with. But he was different. Zach? Mum's eyebrows contracted to hide behind her sunglasses. I haven't heard that name. Is he one of your usual group? No, like Mum had any clue who she hung with. But he is in a group. Oh. Mum sat up straighter, though she kept both hands locked on the steering wheel, determined to prove how responsible she was. Anyone I know? Not unless you're into the stoned drifters. Mum pursed her lips, the possibility evidently worth her consideration. You don't know them, Mum, Taylor said, reaching for the CD player. Mum flicked her knee, sticky from the spilled soft drink. Hungry? No. Energy in, energy out, and we haven't actually moved in, like, 2 hours. Taylor pressed play, cranking the volume. You know, I should have used you for my psych thesis. You're an enabler.
I believe in empowerment, not enabling. Eating junk food is self-destructive. If I encouraged that, perhaps I'd be an enabler. But I don't, and I'm not. Rice cake or almonds?
A force feeder, then. Her mother had a thing about clearing plates and eating vegetables so kids overseas didn't starve. Mum reached across to rummage in the console, then held packets towards Taylor without taking her eyes from the road. As Taylor chose the bribe, her mother cleared her throat. Taylor tensed. She knew what was coming. Mum was desperate to confide in her, and Taylor was equally desperate not to hear a word of it.
You know, Taylor, Dad and I...
Mum, give it a rest. I came along to keep you company. I don't want to be involved. Her mother's forefinger tapped the wheel, a metronome measuring her patience. Her eyes squinted against the afternoon sun.
Tay, I'm just concerned.
She would monologue for the next 10 kilometres about self-care and heart healing and acceptance of fate. So Taylor jammed her earbuds back in, pretending she couldn't hear. The stoned drifters played loud. Not loud enough to drown out her thoughts, though. Living in a house with cardboard-thin walls, her parents' marital problems weren't something Taylor needed to have confirmed. Nor did she need to be a sounding board for either of them. The hot vinyl scorched her bare feet as she stuck them on the dash.
Taylor?
Michelle, she shot back, though she knew what was coming.
Feet down. They'll get burnt. The glass magnifies the rays. Although the ozone layer is so depleted, we'll all be fried to a crisp soon enough. Fancy some organic corn chips?
She yanked out her earbuds.
No.
She stuck her hand in the bag anyway. Aren't you sick of driving? Mum pushed the sunglasses onto her head and knuckled her eyes.
A bit.
Want me to take over?
No, you had wine with lunch.
One glass, Mum. Not even a full serve. I'm sure the pub ripped me off.
Can't risk it.
Trust you to be a stickler for the rules. Except those with a till death do us part theme. They stopped overnight at Hay, the cream, red and brown brick checkered motel room, almost palatial after being cooped up in the car for 9 hours. With only 600 kilometres remaining, they left late the next morning. Roadhouse is not responsible for thinning ozone and polar bear extinction then, Taylor said, as Mum brought steak sandwiches and mugs of coffee over to the tiny, chrome-edged table by the window overlooking the highway.
We're all equally to blame for the problems and responsible for the solution, Mum said, chasing a dribble of froth from the side of the cup with her finger. It's up to each of us to save the world for tomorrow.
There was a lot of weed around in the early 80s, right? 5 hours later, after her second turn behind the wheel, Taylor settled into the passenger seat, tapping out a message to Zack. He wouldn't be up. Probably no one in his house would. She'd been there just once. A dive shared with a bunch of other musos. Co-tenanting was the only way anyone under 30 could afford a place in Sydney. But Zack didn't plan on hanging around New South Wales much longer. Next year he'd be on tour. First Australia, then Asia. She zipped the crucifix along her necklace. Warmed by the sun, the metal was hot on her chest. Mum glanced across the car.
I see you wear that a lot.
A lot being a relative term, given that I've only had it a couple of weeks. Although it wasn't the type of jewellery she normally chose, something about the unexpected gift from her grandparents appealed. Do you think it's pure silver? It seems to react with my skin.
Gross.
Not like that. More a tingle, like it's conducting an electrical current. Mum lifted one shoulder.
Check for the stamp. Should have a 925 if it's silver. And make sure you thank your grandparents for the necklace when we get there.
Seriously, Mum? Her mother vacillated between being a ditzy best friend one moment and parenting as though Taylor was a teen the next.
Uh-huh. Have a look. 925 for silver, 375 for gold.
So not what I meant.
Off.
Mum tapped Taylor's foot, propped on the dash again. Taylor squinted out the window. All the way to the horizon, starry explosions of vivid lemon-yellow flowers crowned paddocks of thigh-high emerald-green plants. Her eyes watered, sinuses aching in anticipation of hay fever. What do you reckon that is?
Rape.
What?
Devil's weed.
You just don't like the colour. Or maybe there's something a little more specific you'd care to share.
Rapeseed, brassica, canola, Mum expanded. But at least the South Australian government has the sense not to allow the genetically modified version here.
She shook her head dolefully,
because everywhere else, the bees. Those poor bees.
Speaking of insects, I don't get why you're fixated on camping, Taylor said, swiftly deflecting the environmental rant. I thought the whole point of this odyssey was to catch up with the Grands. Though Mum had made an annual pilgrimage to the farm her parents had moved to as caretakers, after a brief flirtation with the grey nomad lifestyle, Taylor hadn't been there since she was 13. She could vaguely remember being seduced by patting cute farm animals, but through the intervening years, the beaches and friends and malls, and eventually nightlife, of Sydney had held far more allure.
Camping is fun.
The clipped tone made it sound like Mum was quoting a bumper sticker, and Taylor glanced up to check the car in front of them, which was about 2 kilometres away.
"Sounds a bit eat, pray, love to me," she said suspiciously.
The book had been keeping Nicholas Sparks company on the coffee table the last few weeks. "But I'm sure you could find yourself in a nice 5-star hotel out there." Mum snorted with laughter, and the lost familiarity of the sound brought a smile to Taylor's lips.
"You really don't remember Settlers Bridge, do you?"
"Why?" Taylor's smile dropped as unease prickled through her.
"There are a couple of pubs, but I doubt you're going to find any 5-star accommodation."
"It has to have changed in the decade since I was there."
"You think? Gran said it hasn't changed since she was a girl. Anyway, if you remember the town, you must remember that last time you stayed, we went camping. So I thought we'd do it again now you're an adult. A full circle kind of thing."
Taylor bit back a groan. She should have realised. As her marriage floundered, Mum seemed intent on trying to return to a time when things had been happier. Of course, Dad had also been on that camping trip.
"You'll break that if you keep fiddling with it."
"That's not what the sexual health flyers say." Taylor dropped the pendant she'd been sliding up and down the chain.
"It was nice of your grandparents to send it," Mum said in a determined tone.
"It was odd of them to send it," Taylor corrected. "Given that my entire life their gifts have been a very predictable $20 bill every single birthday."
Mum shrugged. "The face value of money has no relevance to them. It's the thought that counts."
"Or the calendar entry." The money arrived exactly 2 business days before her birthday each year. The note so crisp it must have been ironed. Mum grimaced and flicked the vent shut as the stench from roadkill filled the car.
"Gramps said they found the necklace and the owner suggested they give it to someone who would appreciate it."
Hidden behind sunglasses, Taylor closed her eyes, mentally counting to 5. She understood the psychological urge that drove Mum to revert to the familiar behaviour of a period when life had seemed safer, more predictable. And kudos to her. Even though she was inappropriately parenting a 22-year-old, she'd managed to stop short of saying, "Don't look a gift horse in the mouth." But Taylor would return the necklace to her grandparents. It wasn't worth a sermon about her need to show gratitude. Her fingers closed around the pendant, holding it tight.
"Look, the mighty Murray."
Mum nodded at the narrow bridge arching in front of them.
"We could have crossed at the ferry at Tailham Bend, but we'll save that for another day."
Yay, primed for excitement. Despite her sarcasm, Taylor straightened as they passed the town limits sign, "Welcome to Settlers Bridge." The bridge spanned swampy river flats studded with fat brown cows and large white hook-billed birds wading through the marsh on long legs. These ibis looked different, more regal than the bin chickens of city life. As they crossed the water, a rectangular houseboat contentedly chunted beneath the bridge, the river parting in a creamy green wake either side of the boat. The upper deck was spread with loungers and beach towels, and a woman waved from the prow. That would have been a better option than camping. The road surged up a short, steep hill from the bridge, then expanded into 4 lanes as it entered the town, the pairs bisected by a brick-paved centre strip punctuated with flowering bushes. Taylor took in the short, deserted street at a glance. There were a couple of old 2-storey pubs at the bridge end. Faded iron verandas overhung antiquated shops either side of the road, the drop between the footpath and stone-paved gutter dangerously deep. Further up, she could make out a sandwich board outside a cafe. They wouldn't starve, but that might be the only thing in the tiny town's favour. Despite the nearness of the river and the great candle-like plumes of orange and pink bougainvillea bushes in the island dividing the roads, the town was dry and dusty, as though summer had already hit. "I'm sure I hear banjos in the distance," she muttered. "Tumbleweed will blow down the street any moment now, though at least that'll be something moving."
"Oh, look, how cute!"
Mum exclaimed, pulling into a park in front of one of the veranda-shaded shops.
"Ploughs and pies! Isn't that just gorgeous? I'll pick up a cake to take with us."
"Spend your money wisely," Taylor said, jerking a thumb across the road. Almost a mirror image, another cafe sported a similarly painted window, depicting farm machinery and baked goods. You might start a turf war.
Tractors and tarts, Mum read as she took her purse from the console. That's awesome. Well, I'm sure we'll end up trying both places. Ploughs and pies will do for today, though. Come on, we need to pick up some groceries. There's a supermarket sign down there a bit.
Like driving distance?
Like walking distance, Mum insisted. We've eaten enough junk over the last 2 days. Time to start moving it through our bodies.
You are so gross.
Thought doctors weren't supposed to be grossed out by bodily functions.
I still have a 3-year window of getting grossed out before I'm qualified. Anyway, I have to make a call. Leave the air conditioner on. Mum gave her a look.
What we've done to the ozone layer by driving here is crime enough.
Michelle clambered from the car, groaning as she stretched. Then she disappeared. But Taylor knew her mum had flipped forward to touch her toes, and would at any second swoop past the window in a flurry of tie-dyed pastels as she arched into a backbend. It was probably lucky there was no one around to see her middle-aged, harem-panted mother doing yoga in the middle of the street. As Mum headed into the shop, Taylor wound up her window, privacy more important than the temperature, which shouldn't even be a thing in mid-spring. Obviously, this place was a desert.
Princess.
Zack's voice was gravelly, and she could tell his gig had run late the previous night.
Hey, Zack.
With nothing particular to say, she was simply greedy to hear his voice. They'd spoken the previous night when she was halfway across Australia, and he was halfway to his gig. Mum had been in the shower, so their call had been mutually satisfying.
Your mum there? He said.
No.
She giggled as she realised why he'd asked. But she will be in precisely 90 seconds. I'd hate to think you were that quick.
Fair call. When will you be able to ditch your guard?
The comment irked, but she understood his frustration at her mother's chastity belt presence. I'll have a bit of privacy when we get to the farm.
Come be alone with me then, Princess. At least on the phone, okay?
She was momentarily glad Settlers Bridge was practically a ghost town. There was no one to see her grinning like an idiot.
Sure. How was the gig?
Sweet as. But hey, Princess, I gotta go. I'll give you a call later, okay?
She knuckled the phone to her ear, trying to bring him closer for a moment.
Sure. Catch you then.
Mum smacked a box down on the bonnet.
The government's banning plastic bags in South Australia from next year, she crowed, and apparently the shops here have already got on board. How's that for progressive?
Taylor clambered from the car and hauled the boot open. You mean regressive. And you are literally the only person in the history of ever to get excited by that news.
Mum held up both hands. People your age are supposed to be all about the environment.
People her age were supposed to be all about getting on with their lives, not babysitting their parents through their midlife crises.
Samantha says your grandparents were in town yesterday, telling everyone we were coming over, Mum said as she slid behind the steering wheel.
Samantha?
She owns Ploughs and Pies.
Mum shook her head in admiration. She's probably only about your age, too.
First name terms with the locals. Trust Mum.
Probably hasn't had to spend a quarter of her life at med school amassing a hex debt.
She packed me up a honey Swiss roll, said it's your gran's favourite.
I'm sure whatever stale item she had the most of is gran's favourite.
Mum gave a despairing huff. I don't understand why you have to be so cynical, Tay. If you give them a chance and get to know them, most people are actually nice.
Her mother was hopelessly naive. It would be charming if it wasn't so irritating. I'm into science, Mum. Evidence-based fact. And the fact is that most people are only out for what they can get. So you can say people are nice all you like, but if you don't mind, I'll hold out for the proof.
2. Anna. South Australia, late March, 1877. Even in the earliest hours of the morning, two rooms housing 6 people were never entirely silent. Father stirred on the far side of the thick curtain, inches from Anna's head, and Mother murmured in response. Though mice noisily busied themselves in the rushes on the floor, Anna lay unmoving, so the crackle of hay in their mattress didn't disturb the rhythm of Emily's snores. The ceiling she stared at held no more interest than it had each day of the 18 years she had woken to it. Hessian sacks nailed to wooden beams thicker than her thigh partially hid the iron sheet roof. Mother had insisted they have a ceiling rather than naked tin. While most of the tenant farmers in the hundred of Ziedlerbrücke, or Settlers' Bridge, as Father said they must call it, were of German heritage, Mother had actually been born in Deutschland, and as she often lamented while sighing over the girl's grubby hands or knotted hair, she knew what it was to be civilized. Anna's attention shifted outside. All was quiet, even the white-winged choughs not yet awake. Fingertips pinching her lips to silence her breath, she waited for the rooster to count his hens. If he didn't speak up soon, it might be that a fox had slunk into the coop during the night. Mother didn't need the worry of losing the last of their chickens. Legs dangling over the edge of the bed, Anna tugged her clothes from the straight-backed chair, exchanging her nightdress for a chemise, flannel drawers, heavy petticoat, and a long-sleeved calico day dress. She twitched aside the curtain that separated her and Emily's bed from the main room, the velvet soft in her hands. Skirting the scrubbed wooden table and chairs, she made for the door. Despite the latent warmth held in the stone, her toes curled on the flags as she leaned against a knobbly sapling doorframe to tug on her hobnailed boots. The twins stirred in their cot beneath a single, thick-paned window as the iron hinges on the door protested the weight of the timber, and she quickly slipped outside before her siblings woke and demanded attention. This early in the day, perhaps she could claim a few precious minutes for herself. The faint light did not bestow a hint of the sun that would, within hours, drive them to seek the sparse shade, but a strong waft of eucalyptus cleared the last of the sleep from her head. The fowls snored and fluffed contentedly in their coop across the yard, and her heartbeat steadied, her pace slowing. Her worry was for naught. They would have eggs enough for another day. Puffs of dust clouded her boots. After breakfast was cleared, the first of her daily chores would be to take a switch to the beaten earth square between the house and outbuildings. If more of her brothers had survived, their home and the bakehouse would not be the only buildings constructed of stone the menfolk cleared from the land. Her fingers tracked the dips and hollows of the crumbling pug and pine wall of the stable. In a few weeks' time, she and Emily would help mix fresh mud and grass and pack it between the pine saplings to weatherproof the structures before winter. Mother would pretend to be unaware of their involvement in the task. A faint scuffle drew Anna's gaze to the scrub beyond the bakehouse. The noise betrayed the presence of a wombat or echidna rooting among dead, crisped leaves for a last mouthful before it tucked itself underground or in a hollow log to escape the heat. She ducked beneath the lintel of the bakehouse, navigating the three steps to the cellar. Perhaps her brother was not so different from the nocturnal creatures.
"What do you want?"
Dieter's deep voice was muffled against the straw mattress. "It's time you were up." She tried to emulate Mother's brisk tone. "I must get the bread on."
"I have not yet heard the birds," he grumbled, as he thrust aside his thin bed cover.
She tossed him the shirt hanging from a peg on the back door, and then rummaged beneath the wooden slab that ran the length of one wall. "I need the buckets." The pails clanged together as she dragged them out.
"Anna," Dieter groaned, "must you make such a din? Is it not your sister's job to fetch the water?"
"Our sister, and yet it seems there is no water in the house." 3 years younger, Emily had inherited Mother's blonde ringlets and blue eyes, where Anna was her father's grey-eyed and brunette image, thankfully without the whiskers. Emily traded on her beauty, turning on charm and waterworks in equal measure to avoid chores and punishment. To be fair, she was good with the 4-year-old twins and spent hours embroidering their clothes or arranging Frederica's hair. Mother said it was well that Emily was pretty and accomplished in the finer skills. Being lazy and forgetful, she would never be of use as a farmer's wife,
so would need to catch a rich man's eye. Useful and ordinary, Anna was uncertain where this left her. Dieter yawned.
Give me a moment to wake, and I will come with you. The waterhole is full of snakes this summer.
Although 9 years and 2 dead siblings separated them, she and Dieter were closer than the twins. He pulled on boots, then stood to adjust his breeches, his head brushing the rafters. Perhaps you can dig the floor lower in here so it is less cramped, she suggested, though she knew Dieter wouldn't lower the floor because he had his eye on Caroline Schencher. Either that, or he had developed a devout interest in church, attending weekly for the last 3 months, since Caroline had returned from 2 years in Europe. Soon he would speak his intention, and then he would look to lease his own land and build a home. Anna didn't like the thought, but that was the way it must be. At least Caroline would have a life. Anna suspected her own might be spent here with her parents, being useful and ordinary. As they crossed the paddock below the house, the dead grass beneath their feet powdered to fill the cracks that split the earth. With the gate of wire and posts awkward to open, and even more difficult to close, they preferred to scale the stone fence. A chime rang through the air as Dieter rapped on the wall of a ploughshare to scare away the snakes and lizards that populated the caves and crannies. It was a trick many of their neighbours emulated. The sheep couldn't breach the 3-foot-high barrier, but tufts of soft brown wool decorated where they rubbed against the stonework. The parched land that spread before them was softened by the rosy glow. In a good season, father's wheat crop paid the rent and allowed a little money to be put aside in the hope of one day purchasing the property. But a bad season, and it seemed those were unfairly predominant, saw him owe yet more money to the government. Seated on the wall, Dieter flattened his work-scarred hands on the rough stone, his broad shoulders hunched.
Do you ever dream, Anna?
His gaze was far away, beyond the paddocks. She spread her skirts as she settled beside him. Of course I dream.
No, I mean dream of more, of a different life.
Much though she loved Dieter, Anna dared not tell even him of her secret dream. It was too ridiculous to be revealed. Instead, she shared a more acceptable truth. I dream that one day I shall marry and have a house of my own, though it seems the chances of that are negligible, and limited even more by our beautiful sister. Dieter didn't rise to the invitation to joke about Emily, but nor did he reassure Anna. So she tried to guess what weighed heavily on his shoulders. I know your dream, Dieter Fran. Your dream is blonde and pretty and attends church each Sunday, nein? He grinned, slight colour rising in his tanned cheeks. The scrub at their backs shivered as a kookaburra exploded into mirthless laughter. As always, inexplicable dread tingled down Anna's spine. Dieter clapped to silence the bird, then pointed. Look. A mob of kangaroos bounded over the wall a short distance from them, 2 joeys leaning out of their mother's pouches, as though encouraging them to greater speed. They play. Dieter snorted.
You're a funny one, Marcian. They head for the water.
Little mouse. He often called her that. Not that she was particularly tiny, although her Sunday corset did nip her waist into an acceptable proportion. Glad his melancholy had passed, Anna tossed a piece of shale into the distance. You and father will take the dray to fetch barrels of water tomorrow? From the corner of her eye, she caught his grimace.
That we will.
It would take them 6 hours to make the journey to Settlers Bridge and return with precious barrels of water pumped from the Murray River. The water would be carefully eked out for household use, filling the animal troughs and sustaining their struggling vegetable garden. Here, water had more value than the gold discovered at Kanmantu, 20 miles northeast. At least you will be afforded the opportunity to swim. She could not imagine water surrounding her entire body. The weekly luxury of the hip bath,
when occasionally it was her turn to use the water first, was as close as she could ever hope to come. Dieter swung himself off the wall. Not much time for that, Marcin. Come, let us finish your sister's task. Impatient at her clumsiness in long skirts, he lifted her down. The land dropped gradually from the house to a gorge that seemed to promise the relief of a rushing torrent. But it was a lie. The ravine, worn deep by a flood some time past, was filled with boulders. Between these travelled the slimmest trickle of water, already busy with bees and dragonflies. Taking an iron pannikin from the well, Dieter slid down the bank to kneel on a raft of bulrushes. He leaned forward and swept away the dull scum on the water. The reeds crackled and he tensed, a dripping finger pressed to his lips to silence Anna. As clumsy footfalls punctured the hush, Dieter's shoulders eased. Listen. A snake would have struck silently. Droplets showered from the full tin as Dieter clambered back up the slope. He primed the pump with the precious liquid. The cast iron lever squealed as he heaved it up and down, and a grin flashed across his face.
That will wake everyone.
Not before time. Pink fringed the eastern horizon. Red sky at night, shepherd's delight. Red sky in the morning, shepherd take warning. Hopefully it would rain today. Muddy water gushed from the spout, splashing into the pail, and they counted Dieter's pumps in unison. One, two, three. The well wasn't good, a small pool at the bottom of the 20-foot shaft, and the number of pumps it took to fill a bucket indicated how close it was to running dry. But it was one of the few in the district that provided usable water, almost enough to keep them alive. Some of them, anyway. In the 9 years since the last drought, Father had restored his flock, but Anna's brothers, who lay in the graveyard beside the church, could not be replaced. She lugged two pails to Dieter's two heavy buckets as they traipsed back up the paddock. You'll take lunch with you tomorrow?
Have you ever known me to go anywhere hungry?
Her brother's appetite was renowned. What treasure would you have me bring you back this time? This was her favourite game, and she stared into the sun-kissed distance, seeing riches that could only ever exist in her imagination. A fan of ostrich feathers should suffice, kind sir. There was a general store at the river's edge, but Dieter could spare no money. Last winter the season had been kinder, and when he and Father herded the sheep to the market, Dieter had purchased two lengths of ribbon, red for her and blue for Emily. Anna's was longer, although Dieter swore he ordered 2 feet of each. The sisters had tucked the gifts into the hope chests beneath their bed. Mother had started the collections when they were infants and added items as finances permitted, and Anna and Emily opened the boxes often to review the scant contents, as though they did not have them memorized. Still, they didn't compare to the magnificence of the Aussteuerschrank Mother had brought from Germany. The carved wardrobe protected the embroidered linens and satin, lengths of ribbon and spun lace that Mother had gathered when she was younger than Anna, in preparation for marriage to a man she had yet to meet. The first time she set eyes on Father was at their betrothal, a week after her ship made land in Port Adelaide. Anna and Dieter carefully skirted the paddock of rye Father grew solely to make their heavy, dark bread, and approached the house through the small, struggling orchard and vegetable garden fenced with sticks she and Emily had gathered from the nearby scrub. Already the stone cottage offered a haven from the sun, although a wisp of smoke curled from the chimney. The bulk of their cooking was done in the bakehouse, off to one side of the cottage, but a fire was needed in the house to heat water and provide breakfast. Dieter placed the buckets near the door, wide open now to allow in the light. A dull chime announced their presence as his hip brushed the iron triangle hung low near the door. It was Frederick's favourite job to take the length of forged iron rod and strike the triangle to summon the men in from the paddocks. Mother straightened from measuring oats into the pot in the hearth. pressing her hand to the small of her back. Guilt pinched Anna's insides, followed by a flash of anger. It was her job to have the breakfast on, but Emily's fault she was delayed. Eyes on the mound of Mother's stomach, a silent prayer moved Anna's lips.
Please, God, don't let it be twins again.
One more child would add enough to Mother's troubles, let alone two. While Frederick and Frederica seemed hale and hearty, it was only a few years since the older twins had died within a day of each other. Diphtheria claimed Christoph, and although Carl had shown no symptoms, when his twin died, he had simply lain on their bed and closed his eyes. Forever. Now, whenever the younger twins fell ill, Anna sensed Mother hold her breath in fear.
Mother, let me take care of breakfast. You need to ready yourself for church.
Mother's brow arched.
You think I become slow? It is well Unser Vater blesses me with your assistance, then.
Mother wasn't particularly religious, but she liked to credit God with anything good in her life. Father, on the other hand, was as likely to curse God, but never within Mother's hearing.
I do wish this heat would break. It is beyond time. At home, trees clothed in the most beautiful shades herald autumn.
Mother sighed.
I dream you shall one day see them, Anna.
It unsettled her when Mother referred to Germany as home. Would you return to Deutschland, Mother? Mother waved the ladle in her direction.
Gott in Himmel, never again will I be incarcerated for 3 months in the bowels of a ship.
Her blue eyes danced to Anna's father as he pushed through the bedroom curtain.
No, I've made my bed. Now it seems I must lie in it.
Is that not so, Johann?
Tugging his short, grey beard into a point, Anna's father pretended to take Mother seriously.
Ah, Joanna, what am I to do with you? I cannot return you to your own parents. You are named for me. No, we are peas, and this is our pot.
Her skirts brushing the flags, Mother went to him and pressed her hand to his cheek.
You know I would be nowhere else, husband.
Father took her hand and kissed her palm. Then she turned back to Anna.
Wake your sister. She can ready the twins for church. You must make certain she does her chores while we are gone.
Her parents, the twins, and Dieter had breakfasted quickly and departed early. Mother and the children rode in the buggy, but as Father and Dieter walked, it would take them almost an hour and a half to reach the Kirche. By the time her family sat for service, Anna had swept the yard, dusted, made the beds with fresh linens, and set the dirty ones to soak in the copper tub beneath the silver-trunked gum tree. Emily, however, seemed to have achieved nothing. Anna dragged Mother's oak rocking chair aside and rolled the rag rug. One day, the grey and brown history of their outworn clothing would cover the floor. But for now, the rug was small enough that she could take it outside and beat the dust from it. Her shoulders strained as the two sisters struggled to lift the rug over a rope strung between two trees. Emily put some effort into it. They had much to do before the others returned for lunch. Emily flapped her thin, elegant hands.
But it's heavy!
Anna ducked beneath the rope and tugged the rug from the opposite side. No more so than last week. At the very least, stop it from sliding. Finally, with the rug balanced, she wedged a forked sapling under the line to lift it from the ground. She dashed a hand across her damp brow. The air was ominously still and thick, like congealed pig's blood, and it was hard to draw breath. Lightning crackled in the distance, and she turned to watch the forked flash. She lifted her chin toward the bright illumination.
I hope rain chases that.
Emily followed her gaze.
I cannot smell any.
Nor I, but perhaps a change will blow through. Then Father and Dieter will hunt tonight.
Emily's eyes grew huge.
But it is Sunday.
Yes, and we shall use the last joint of mutton for lunch. So unless the rabbit traps come up full, tomorrow you shall be complaining of an empty belly. Anyway, Father says hunting is sport, not work.
I would rather go hungry than invite his punishment.
Emily said. I would keep your pious belief in mind if the men bring home a roux. Anna tried not to allow her lips to pinch together too much, mindful of her mother's admonition that it was an old maid's habit. But sometimes it seemed that twins had more common sense than Emily. As I recall, you enjoy fresh meat as much as any of us. She wiped her hands on her apron. I shall fetch the mutton if you can see your way clear to stoking the oven. Wrapped in calico, the salted meat swung from the cool room ceiling. Anna unhooked it and sniffed. A little green, but not too offensive. And it was not yet infested by maggots. The sand-filled root box yielded 4 potatoes and 2 carrots. She would make gravy with scrapings from the vegetables, a little flour, and fat rendered from the joint. A jar of mother's sauerkraut and thick slices of bread would supplement the meal. Far from the worst fare they had eaten, there had been leaner seasons. The preparations complete, she seized the clover-leaf paddle that leaned against the wall and headed back to the clothesline. Emily was nowhere in sight. Anna huffed and raised her eyes to the heavens her sister so respected. Would it be wrong to pretend the rug was Emily's bottom as she beat the dust from it? Wrong or not, the pretense helped her find energy in the stifling heat, and she was so invested in her task that the crack as thunder split the heavens caught her by surprise. A willy-willy swirled through on a hot northerly gust, tangling tumbleweed around her feet and throwing grit into her eyes. Skirt billowing, she strained into the wind. Her hands tightened on the wooden paddle and her stomach knotted. She hesitantly licked her lips, wanting to deny the acrid taste that spiked fear through her chest. The sour tang of burning leaves and green wood filled the air with the smell of death. 3. Taylor.
Come in, loves. The door's open. A vaguely familiar voice sing-songed from the depths of the old farmhouse.
Instead of following the direction, Taylor swiveled, surveying the walled back garden. Parched, like the town she and Mum had left 15 kilometres back. The only greenery was spindly couch grass thrusting between the pavers that surrounded a weed-choked pond. A small fountain spouted sporadically, as though the effort to pump was too great to be sustained. The sun reflected from the dry ground, the walls trapping the heat so that Taylor stood in an oven that shouldn't exist this early in the spring. Beyond the garden, though it was barely deserving of the title, was farmyard. Kilometres of the stuff. Grass and outcrops of rock dotted with stands of lanky trees. Dozens of dirty grey sheep. And millions of flies. Tiny little black things that clustered at her eyes and her lips like she offered an oasis in the desert. God knows what magic she had imagined in the farm as a 13-year-old, but she guessed it had been related to the novelty of petting various barnyard animals, rather than a more adult survey of the surrounds. Mum dropped the metal bar she'd used to strike an iron triangle hung beside the door. It swung on a piece of frayed black twine, as though it had found some breeze in the airless pocket of heat. As the reverberation of the clanging iron died away, Mum took a deep breath.
Come on, then.
She sounded nervous. Perhaps she anticipated questions about why she'd found it necessary to suddenly flee Sydney. Or worse, maybe she was eager to launch into teary answers. Taylor grimaced. Physical ills could be treated, sutured, and medicated, but the heart was an organ, a muscle. There was no point attributing emotions to it, creating issues even the best cardiologist couldn't address. But that fact was one of many she and Mum would never agree on. The chipped, grey-painted screen door slammed behind them, and Mum flinched. A narrow rectangular room stretched to their left and right. Window seats were piled with boxes and empty jars, old newspapers and shopping bags, and one wall was lined with a motley combination of white malamine and towering pine cupboards. Beneath a bank of dusty louvers were a deep stainless steel sink and a twin tub washing machine.
People still use those? Taylor murmured. Mum ignored her. Hello, she called. In here, Michelle. Taylor followed her mother to the end of the room, where Mum squared her shoulders, then pushed at another door. The wood, unlike the hollow doors at home, was carved in four heavy panels. A dimpled glass pane took up the top fifth of the door, well above anyone's head height. Chips in the grey paintwork revealed myriad different colours that would no doubt have thrilled an interior decoration historian. Taylor's grandparents were seated at a bandy-legged, steel-framed kitchen table. What was visible of the swirly blue formica beneath alternately placed white and pink placemats was patchy and faded, as though it had been bleached uncountable times over the decades.
You're just in time, her grandfather said.
After so many years, Taylor wouldn't have recognised him, but there were only two people in the room, and she was pretty sure the one sporting a silver-streaked bun would be Gran. Gramps brushed crumbs from his rounded belly before gripping the edge of the table, swaying forward twice to build momentum, then lurching up from the chair. He collected a black plastic tray from the steel draining board behind him.
Come on, then.
Realising the summons was directed at her, Taylor shot Mum a beseeching look. Mum quirked her lips in an I've no idea fashion and gave a little shrug. Gramps scraped a plate into the tray and shuffled past Taylor, giving her elbow a squeeze with his free hand.
This way, Peach.
Peach?
As Taylor followed him, Gran spoke to Mum. Pop the kettle on, love. I'll warm the pot. It all sounded ridiculously prosaic, as though she and Mum had only visited a day or two ago.
Don't let the flies in, Gramps said as he led the way back out the screen door.
He shuffled across the small, walled garden and dragged open a gate. The wood scraped across the pebbled cement path. Then Gramps threw his head back and released a harsh caw, repeating it three times. The noise echoed off the stone sheds that bordered the large paddock around the house. What? Taylor gasped.
Watch, Gramps said, grinning in obvious satisfaction at her reaction.
He hobbled toward a small aviary built hard up against a stone wall, the wooden frame splintered and rotting, seemingly held together only by the wire mesh. Stretching up, he tottered so precariously that Taylor hovered close behind, ready to catch him. He placed the tray on the roof of the low building. Then he cawed again.
Now, count. Quick.
Count? And she thought her conversations with Mum bordered on bizarre. Gramps nodded.
It's tea time. See how long it takes them to come.
As he spoke, a great rustle of wings announced the arrival of two ravens. Midnight blue iridescence sheened feathers as glossy and black as Zack's hair. Clawed feet scrabbling on the tin, they suspiciously assessed Taylor from sapphire eyes before hopping toward the tray. Gramps chuckled.
Said you need to count quickly. Some days they're so hungry the entire coven is out here calling me instead of the other way round. All righty, magpies made pikelets, so we'd better get in there before your mum gets them all.
Magpie? Maggie? Was that Gran's name? It didn't sound quite right.
Magpie,
Gramps affirmed without further explanation. Gran, Magpie, proved to be as eccentric as Gramps. Cheerfully pouring cups of tea from a pot on the kitchen table, she passed around a plate of warm pikelets slathered in butter, and another piled with generous slices of the sugar-dusted, cream-filled honey Swiss roll Mum had bought. The entire time, Gran kept up an incessant stream of chatter about weather, food, and neighbours Taylor and Mum didn't know. Mum joined in, talking fast. She waxed lyrical about how Taylor had skipped a year of school, completed her bachelor's degree early, passed the GAMSAT, and was working part-time, despite her crippling post-grad study load. She also managed to get in a humble brag about how many years of sacrifice, guidance, and persuasion had gone into getting Taylor to this point. At cup number two, Gramps insisted Taylor take a tour of the house with him to refresh her memory. He wandered through a warren of rooms she'd never be able to navigate alone, pointing out with all the pride of a homeowner the high cobwebbed ceilings, although he didn't mention the cobwebs, thick walls, and tiny windows designed to lock the harsh sun outside.
By cup number three, having apparently avoided any curly questions about the state of her marriage, Mum suggested they head off to set up their tent while they had daylight. Oblivious to Taylor's lack of enthusiasm, she kept up an excited monologue of, "Oh, do you remember this?" as she eased the car down barely existent tracks where scrawny trees reached out to scratch the paintwork. Textbooks slipped from the seat and into the footwell as they juddered over an endless series of ruts. "Great, $400 down the drain," Taylor muttered.
"Don't be dramatic,"
Mum said, as she pulled the car up dead centre of the paddock, covered with flat, yellow-flowered plants.
"Is that some kind of canola too?" Taylor suggested slyly. It would be degrees of hilarious if they camped in the middle of a genetically modified crop.
"I think it's some kind of weed.
Bet the bees love it, though." Taylor squinted through the window at the acres of scrub bordering the paddock. Why on earth had she thought this place had an enchanted woods quality when she was a kid?
"Bet they love being in the world's most boring mandala. Literally everything out here is khaki or yellow."
"Or, you know, green and gold."
Taylor clambered out. Within five steps, pollen from the black-scented flowers, which looked like coin-sized sunflowers, had turned her boots bright yellow, and she sniffed experimentally. Oddly enough, they hadn't triggered her hay fever. But there was no need to let Mum know that. "What's with all the holes?" she yelped as she stumbled.
"Wombats,"
Mum replied firmly, starting to unload their camping equipment.
"Like you can pick their burrows from any other kind."
The ground was pocked with holes and peppered by sparse tufts of short, wiry foliage, like a teenage boy's face.
"Tay, come help."
Mum's lilting pitch meant she was barely hanging on to her temper. "We need firewood before it gets dark." Taylor frowned. Not much through Mum. At least it hadn't until about a year back. Maybe longer. But Taylor had been too busy to notice when it was that Mum had stopped being Mum. When the irritating rose-coloured glasses through which she viewed the world had been smudged and she'd developed deep frown lines. Taylor jammed her hands into her pockets, her groans shifting a cloud of flies from her face as she stomped back toward the car. Mum's hair had escaped her ponytail, and her pale skin was reddened. Blue nylon puddled at her feet, and she waved thin rods at Taylor.
"Wood?"
Invested in her pretense that this was a bizarre recreation of the holiday from years back, Mum seemed oblivious to the fact that Taylor was giving up precious time. These few days off should have been spent at the club with Cassie watching Zach perform. Or in the hotel room with Zach. She had to remember, though, that she'd chosen to accompany Mum to support her midlife crisis. Had to remember, but didn't have to be particularly happy about it at this moment. She flung out her arms and let them drop heavily. "Where am I supposed to get wood from?" Mum pushed the elastic-jointed rods together, trilling a little laugh as the steel-tipped carbon fibre refused to engage. But Taylor knew the giggle was a pressure gauge release. Mum waved toward the surrounding greyness, the winged sleeves of her boho top drifting in the breeze she created.
"Show a little initiative, love. See the scrub? It's made of, wait for it, wood. Come on, don't be childish."
Childish?
Funny how parents could invoke that accusation with sublime disregard for chronological age. Why couldn't we buy a bag from the petrol station on the way here, you know, like normal people do? Mum's lips pursed into a cat's bum, her tone tightening to match.
"Just get little branches to start with, and watch out for snakes."
"Jesus, Mum, I'm not 13.
Taylor stamped back toward the scrub. Prepared to leap away if something slithered out, she kicked at fallen branches along the fringe of the tangled bushland, then snapped twigs from the closest trees. A vine covered in tiny white, fluffy stars and hanging from a branch like a ghostly stalactite looked like it would probably be flammable. She tugged the strands. The branch creaked ominously and flowers cascaded, covering her head and shoulders like dandruff. Returning to the campground, Taylor dropped her bundle of twigs, scowling as she picked minute, itchy blossoms out of her cleavage.
"Impressive,"
That you got the tent up, I mean, not the Lilliputian dimensions. Where are you sleeping?
Don't be silly,
Mum snapped. The assembly had evidently taken the last of her patience. It's a standard two-man. But a two-man from an actual camping store would be bigger than a Kmart one. You realise that even without a hotel, we could have done this properly. Glamping is a thing. Soft duvet, air mattress. We need more wood, Taylor. And a gas barbecue, she added to her list. I collected all the little bits, like you said. Mum snapped twigs against her hair and panted knee, exerting rather more force than necessary. She jerked her head at the scrub.
Where are the keys? I'm going back to the house first, Taylor said. I forgot to go to the loo.
By the way, how bizarre was it there? Like we'd never been away. I'll probably need therapy to erase the scars of that weirdness. Invoking the word therapy was generally a great way to get Mum back on board.
You can't erase scars. You can only help them fade.
Mum had a knack for sighing without making a sound, a deflation of her entire body and a long-suffering tilt to her chin.
And it wasn't bizarre. My parents are just easy to be with. If you cut through the scrub and across the paddocks, it's probably only a kilometre or so.
What is?
The homestead. The toilet.
I'll take the car.
Can't. The tent's tied to it, just for tonight so we can see if it holds up in the wind.
You know I wouldn't walk that far even if it was a shopping mall.
I'm sure you have to do far more steps in clinical prac.
Mum dusted off her knees and then went to the scant rectangle of shade cast by the tent. She produced a small shovel from behind the esky, unfolding it with a flourish.
Here you go, then. Toilet paper is in the glove box. Make sure you bury it.
You are joking, right?
Not at all. Gramps said the foxes are bad out here. They might dig it up.
Not that, Taylor snapped. I mean, you expect me to go out there?
People have managed with less.
And people died from cholera and dysentery. Generally, humans strive to improve their lot, not voluntarily go back to their roots.
Rivulets of sweat trickled down Taylor's back, and without sniffing too deeply, she knew her deodorant wasn't up to the challenge. Her head itched from the flowers, and her hands were filthy. And it had been hours since the grocery store in Settlers Bridge, and still Zack hadn't called back. She wasn't sure whether to be more irritated by that or by her need to have him call. Mum bent from the waist, laying sticks in the sandy pit she had dug.
Okay, I suggest you take it easy on the food, then.
Taylor snatched the shovel and strode away, spiky rushes spearing her ankles, the cratered surface seeking to trip her. Despite appearing sparse, the wood held an air of hushed seclusion as she penetrated beyond the first row of scruffy trees. Jeans around her ankles, she overbalanced, wobbling into a yellow-flowered bush the size of a car.
Shit!
The plant was covered in thorns hidden by delicate, wattle-puff flowers instead of leaves.
You all right, love?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.